The next item of business is a statement by Shona Robertson on transvaginal mesh implants. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Shona Robertson. Up to 10 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity today to make a statement about the independent review of transvaginal mesh. I'd like to begin by thanking all of those who contributed to the review, and indeed I would particularly want to thank Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy, whose efforts along with other members of the Scottish Mesh Survivors helped to bring about the review. Indeed, the review was established partly as a result of a petition lodged by the Scottish Mesh Survivors with the Public Petitions Committee back in April 2014. That petition asked for several things, including the suspension of mesh procedures, the establishment of an independent review, the mandatory reporting of adverse events, and the introduction of fully informed consent. Much of this has been or will be achieved as a result of that original petition, and I'll go into more detail shortly. What cannot be denied, however, is that this independent review has been a very difficult and challenging process. And indeed, in addition to the resignation of Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy, we also saw the resignation of a clinician member due to a disagreement with other clinicians about the clinical evidence. In any review or inquiry of this nature, there will always be a wide range of views and experiences and a myriad of evidence and other material to consider. The review's terms of reference specified that it would determine the safety of vaginal mesh implants for both stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse and determine the relative efficacy of surgery for those conditions. In doing so, it was expected to consider a wide range of material, from patient experiences to scientific and statistical information, whilst always bearing in mind that the patient should be put first. However, the difficulties and challenges in bringing this independent review is something that we do need to reflect further upon as a government, including formally examining how future reviews are undertaken and concluded. And I'll keep Parliament informed of the detail of this as it's taken forward. The seriousness that this government attaches to this issue is reflected in the fact that back in 2014, my predecessor, Alec Neil, as Cabinet Secretary, established the independent review of transvaginal mesh. Further, the then Cabinet Secretary asked that health boards consider suspending the use of mesh until such times as the independent review reported. That request for suspension is something that I've given my continued support to, though it must be noted that if women were experiencing very distressing symptoms and wanted to proceed, then in those difficult circumstances, procedures did go ahead, provided the women concerned were fully informed of the risks. Importantly, it must be remembered that only the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, the UK regulatory body, has the power to ban the use of mesh, and they have not done so. What both my predecessor and I were very mindful of was that this should be an independent review, and to that end, all ministers and government officials have taken great care to allow the review to develop a fully independent, comprehensive view on the matter without interference from government. As we all know, and as I alluded to a moment ago, the review has been challenged in recent weeks with the resignation of three valuable members amid concerns that evidence had been ignored, hidden, or deleted. These were very serious concerns, and I raised them directly with the Chair. She's confirmed that all evidence considered by the review has been published either in the final report or on the review's website. In addition to this, I asked the Chief Medical Officer to carefully review the evidence contained within the report to ensure that she considered the evidence to be the best available. The Chief Medical Officer has given me her assurances and professional judgment that the evidence in the report is the best available at this time. The Chief Medical Officer also made herself available to MSPs this morning to answer any detailed clinical questions about the report. On hearing of their resignations, I arranged to meet with Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy and took note of all of their concerns. I then met with the Chair, who discussed those concerns with me in depth, and have sent a very detailed response to Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy based on those discussions. I'm sure that many members here today will now have had a chance to read the review's final report and will have noted the conclusions outlined in it. What is clear from the report is that in the past there have been serious issues around mesh procedures, and members will note that it makes two very clear recommendations in relation to the circumstances they can be offered in the future. One is that when women are treated for stress, urinary incontinence, all appropriate options, both mesh and non-mesh, can be offered, and crucially, women must be given full information to make an informed choice. The second is that mesh procedures must not be offered routinely in the case of pelvic organ prolapse. These recommendations are clear, unambiguous, and incredibly important. We can also see that the final conclusion makes clear that the reporting of adverse events must be mandatory and be in line with the General Medical Council guidance. This, again, is a very important recommendation that will help contribute to much improved monitoring of mesh procedures in the future. Indeed, when I met with the Chair, she explained that the word mandatory is used as a direct result of this request from Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy. So whilst it's deeply unfortunate that we got to the stage where these two very committed women felt they had no choice but to resign, we can nonetheless see that they have had a direct impact upon the report. Indeed, their efforts, along with those of many women affected, have led to other key achievements outside of the independent review. A helpline has been established where any women affected by this issue can seek expert advice. A patient information and consent leaflet has been developed that is designed to help those suffering from stress urinary incontinence to make a careful, properly informed decision about their treatment. And of course, it was through their campaign that the Scottish Government initially requested that these procedures be suspended. Looking to the future, I can today confirm that the Chief Medical Officer has written to health boards drawing their attention to the review's report. Health boards will be fully expected to implement the conclusions set out by the review, and the Chief Medical Officer has in particular highlighted the conclusions around the circumstances in which mesh procedures can and cannot be offered, which I mentioned a few moments ago. It's vitally important that all health boards ensure that the most up-to-date, detailed yet patient-friendly information is available to all women. This information must be provided so they can make careful, fully informed decisions on the best treatment in their case. The CMO will meet with medical directors to ensure that these further safeguards are in place prior to any procedures using mesh being reintroduced routinely in individual health boards. What I can also say today is that an oversight group will now be formed to work with health boards to ensure that the national aspects of the independent review's conclusions are taken forward. To that end, the Scottish Government is in discussion with Health Improvement Scotland with a view to their assuming responsibility for the oversight group. Health Improvement Scotland will, and indeed be well placed, to develop and oversee the implementation of measures in close partnership with health boards to ensure that the independent review's conclusions are implemented. I'm also very keen to ensure, and indeed to continue to stress, is that the patient must at all times be central to the oversight group's work. And I've asked that Healthcare Improvement Scotland build upon its existing processes that would allow this in a meaningful and purposeful way. Finally, and in addition to the work that the oversight group will be expected to carry out, I can also confirm that the Scottish Government officials are exploring a pilot of a specific mesh registry in collaboration with colleagues elsewhere in the UK. Again, this is something requested by women affected by mesh. Presiding Officer, I hope that what I've said today helps to set out my position on the independent review of transvaginal mesh. The independent review's report has an important role in shaping the future approach that health boards will be expected to take. The action that will be taken by the Scottish Government in response to the report's publication gives a very clear message that all women must be offered high quality options, information and support that will allow them to make an informed decision about the best possible treatment in their case. The safeguards put in place will ensure that procedures undertaken by clinicians in Scotland are monitored with transparency, so assuring quality and safety. And let me end by once again thanking all involved in this process for their efforts, particularly the women affected by mesh, who have worked incredibly hard in difficult circumstances to raise awareness of this issue and to bring about meaningful change. I'm happy to answer any questions on my statement.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statements, for which I intend to allow around 20 minutes. It would be helpful if members would press their buttons if they wish to ask questions, please. And I call on Jackson Carlow.
Presiding Officer, it was my privilege to sit in this Parliament's Public Petitions Committee when Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy first presented their shocking, damning and harrowing evidence and testimony on behalf of then dozens of women and since then hundreds, indeed thousands across the world, regarding what so many now openly regard as one of the great health scandals, transvaginal mesh. I recall these women first being dismissed as delusional, of making connections and assertions that were not true. I can recall the incredulity, tears and fury of women as the MHRA sat in front of over 100 Scottish survivors while claiming there were barely a handful affected across the whole of the UK. And it's important to remember and understand how heroic these women have been. They have had to stand, sit and discuss the most intimate and personal details relating to their personal anatomy with men with whom I imagine they never anticipated or expected they would have to have such conversations. That in itself, I think, must have been traumatic for them. I can remember the small measure of pride I felt when this Scottish Parliament, and heroically, the then Health Secretary Alec Neil announced a temporary ban and the conclusions of which we're discussing today. Not only was this a response to the women concerned here in Scotland, it drew the eyes of the world to the lead Scotland had taken. Now, I don't want to dismiss the review out of hand, and I won't, but, Presiding Officer, this is a final publication which bears little of any resemblance to the interim review published last year. It's not just an evolution, but an alleged miracle based on new evidence which suddenly recasts mesh as an appropriate procedure for women. It's, and I'm sorry to say this, and I do so reluctantly, a whitewash of damning evidence now traduced and downgraded, an international reclassification of mesh as a high-risk procedure, not least by the European Union.
You must come to your question.
It's not the basis for the lifting of the suspension. And I'm asking the Cabinet Secretary today, will she respond positively now to my considered request that there will be no lifting of the suspension on mesh procedures until either or both the Public Petitions Committee or Health Committee of this Parliament have been able to consider the review and take further evidence from the most important people of all, the women affected, together with the expert clinician, who together with them felt they had no option but to resign from the review itself. A whitewash, yes, but will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that a whitewash will not be followed by a betrayal?
Shona Robson.
Can I first of all recognise Jackson Carlow's tenacity on this issue? He has for a long time pursued this issue with me and others, and I think in no small part is why we are have got the review and the suspension that was put in place is down to Jackson Carlow and others. Let me respond to some of the questions that Jackson Carlow asked. Also, I should say, recognise very much his description of the physical challenges involved with the women going about an enormous campaign and piece of work. I hope in my statement I was able to outline some of the achievements that they have gathered and have made over that period. I'm not going to stand here and pretend that they're happy with the conclusions of this report, because I know they are not. However, I hope what they will recognise and what Jackson Carlow will recognise is that the things I outlined in terms of the recommendations of the conclusions and all of the other things, including the mandatory reporting, have been achieved by their campaign. Now, the Jackson Carlow talked about the final publication and the interim report. The final publication builds on the interim report, but of course incorporates much of the evidence that was since publicised between the interim report and the final report. And the reason there was such a gap in time was because of the awaiting of much of that, of those reports, like the Cochrane reports, and that was built in to the final report recommendations. In terms of the lifting of the suspension, I've outlined in my statement that the Chief Medical Officer will have to be satisfied that all of the safeguards that are laid out in the report and indeed in the CMO's letter to boards, which go beyond this report, will have to be in place before any board starts to routinely offer these procedures, and then it can only be done with fully informed consent from those women. I hope that in some way reassures Jackson Carlow.
Neil Finlay.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Mess survivors and their families are furious at this report, and it is a scandal that we only have a few minutes to discuss this as a statement at the end of the parliamentary term. So will the Government bring forward a debate on this in Government time when Parliament returns? Why, despite assurances from the Chair that their submission would be withdrawn because of a complete lack of confidence in the final report, have Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy been betrayed and their evidence included in the final report? Why was the draft report agreed by all members of the review group in 2015 and then changed beyond all recognition by the time of publication? Why was research published in the medical journal Nature that suggested 1 in 7 women will suffer serious MESS risks in their lifetime omitted from the final report? Why are unavoidable and unnecessary procedures that too often cause irreversible problems being continued when there are safer alternatives? I have many, many, many other questions on this report, but a lack of time will not allow me to ask them now, but they will be asked. The world has been watching Scotland on MESH. What they will see is a cover-up, a mission, and a medical establishment stitch-up, and that is both a tragedy and a disgrace. Scottish MESH survivors have been betrayed and misled. But let me say this, the Cabinet Secretary knows these women. They will not lie down, and they will most certainly not accept this whitewash.
Shona Robson.
Can I also begin by paying tribute to Neil Findlay and the work that he has done in pursuing this issue and indeed supporting the women in doing so. He talked about other parliamentary opportunities to discuss this in more detail, and I'm sure there will be more parliamentary opportunities to do that. He compared, as Jackson Carlow did, the interim report and the final report. And as I said to Jackson Carlow, the reason that there was such a time gap between the interim and the final report is that Neil Findlay will be aware that there were studies that were being published in between those reports that were then considered and incorporated into the final report. Neil Findlay outlines a number of specific questions, many of which are in the response that I sent to Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy in terms of the detail of the changes to the chapters, which I raised with the Chair and have detailed in my response to them. And I think, just to say this as well, in terms of the expectation that many women who have written to me over the last few months had, that really they would have been understandably disappointed with anything short of a complete ban on MESH from this report. But I have to say this, that the Scottish Government and the Independent Review never had the power to introduce a ban on MESH. As I've said in my statement, that power only lies with the MHRA, which is the UK regulatory body, and they have chosen and decided not to do so. So we have to be guided by that. If that changes, then clearly that is a different matter, but it hasn't changed. That is their position. So the independent review was looking at, and what circumstances did the clinical evidence say that these procedures should or should not go ahead? And that is the evidence that has been brought forward, and the Chief Medical Officer has said that it is the best available evidence at this current time. But I'm happy, if Neil Findlay wants, for me to send him a copy of the letter that I sent to the women outlining in very great detail some of the chapter changes that he referred to.
Now, that was a long question and answers for the openers for very important information from everyone. I'd ask everybody else to recognise that. So short questions and answers, please, to get through everyone. Rona Mackay to be followed by Alison Harris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The report says that in the case of pelvic organ prolapse, that MESH must not be used. Does the Scottish Government support this recommendation, and is it your expectation that it should be followed by all boards?
Shona Robson.
Yes, it is absolutely the case that the report is very clear that pelvic organ prolapse, that MESH must not be used. And it goes into some detail around why they've come to that conclusion. As I said in my statement, what's really important is that not just that conclusion, but all of the other conclusions are now implemented by health boards, including the additional safeguards, the reporting, and making sure that all of those are in place before boards routinely reintroduce procedures on mesh. So I'm very, very clear, and the Chief Medical Officer is very clear that that has to be the case, and she will be keeping me very closely informed as we take that forward.
Alison Harris, followed by Sandra White.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, the eyes of women from across the world are on Scotland. Mesh-injured women, not just in Scotland, not just in the rest of the United Kingdom, but across the Western world, had been eagerly awaiting the independent review report and will be rightly disappointed with its contents. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary if she shares my disappointment with the removal of an entire chapter and its accompanying evidence highlighting the dangers of transvaginal mesh surgery from the final report, and if she can explain why it is not recommended for transvaginal mesh procedures to be reclassified to the highest possible risk category, as has happened in the United States and in accordance with the recently issued European Union guidelines.
Shona Robson.
Can I thank Alison Harris for her questions? The Chair has assured me that all of the evidence is either in the final report or is on the website. All of the evidence that was received, and indeed the clinician who resigned from the group provided an alternative commentary and chapter based on his clinical view that has also been provided on the website for everyone to be able to see. Now, the member talks about reclassification. The MHRA is the body that would reclassify mesh, and we would await, of course, any reclassification from MHRA, but it is their responsibility to determine the classification of mesh, not the Scottish Government's responsibility. Our responsibility is to give clear guidance to clinicians around in what circumstances they should or should not be undertaking these procedures. That's what the independent reviews was set out to do, and that is those are the recommendations it has made. I understand that for many women, they wanted the review to ban mesh. I think I've explained, and I hope I've explained, that it was not within the gift of either the independent review or the Scottish Government. Only the MHRA could do that, and they have not done so. But I'm happy if the member wants to write to her in more detail.
Sandra White, followed by Anna Sarwar.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank the Chief Medical Officer for the very informative meeting today. Cabinet Secretary, myself and others have been contacted by many women who underwent this procedure and are still suffering greatly the consequences of it. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why, when there are women who are being left in such pain, are mesh implant procedures resuming? Surely women should have the choice.
Shona Robson.
Sandra White's last point about the choice is critical here, because what the report clearly says that there should be a fully informed choice. For many women, there are, I think, 43% of women at some point in their lives will suffer urinary incontinence problems. And for some, those are very, very devastating symptoms. And it's very important that women have the full choice and that the clinical expertise and guidance is as good as it can be. That is why the independent review's recommendations are so important, because it lays out very clearly in what circumstances procedures should or should not be used, and that for stress urinary incontinence, both mesh and non-mesh procedures should be fully explained, and the benefits and disbenefits and the risks should be fully explained so that women can make a fully informed decision. The report's recommendations will strengthen that, and we will make sure that the guidance, particularly the guidance and the patient information, is as good as it can be so that women can make that informed choice.
Anna Sarwar, to be followed by Alison Johnson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, the most important individuals in this entire situation are the survivors of the mesh scandal. And it is a fact to say that they feel angry, let down and betrayed. Individuals who served on that review group have asked for their submissions to be withdrawn, and they ask why those submissions weren't withdrawn. The First Minister today at First Minister's Questions rightly...
Can we have a question, please, Mr.
Sarwar? ...rightly apologised for the consequences of that treatment. Will the Health Secretary now take this opportunity to apologise for this botched process that has let down so many individuals.
Shona Robson.
Well, can I say to Anna Sarwar that right at the beginning of this process, when myself and the Chief Medical Officer were in front of the committee, I apologised to women for the hurt that they had undertaken, the damage and the injury that they had suffered, and undertook to make sure that going forward that there would be clear clinical guidance, that procedures would have to have fully informed consent, and that the suspension which Alec Neil put in place would continue until all of that work had been done. Now, Anna Sarwar referred to information that the women themselves had asked to be removed. When I met with the women, they asked me that the minority report that they had written should be removed. I passed that information on to the chair. The chair of the independent review group agreed to do that. They then subsequently asked for further information to be removed, and that again was passed on to the chair. But at that point, the report had already been published, and it included a request to remove information from the interim report, which was published 18 months ago. So that information is there, but I don't think anybody is under any illusion of what the women's views are of this report, and I understand that. But what I would say to Anna Sarwar, as I've said to other members here, I think one of the issues here was that the expectation of what the independent review group could achieve in terms of the expectation of many women, as they've written to me, that it should be nothing less than a ban on mesh procedures, was not something that the independent review could have delivered or that the Scottish Government could deliver. That responsibility and power lies only with the MHRA, and they have chosen not to do so in the light of the evidence that they have seen, and that is the fact.
Alison Johnson, followed by Mike Rumbles.
Thank you. 98% of the women in the report said their consent to mesh surgery wasn't informed. 70% said that their surgeon wasn't open to the idea that mesh was the cause of their symptoms. Now, these symptoms have resulted in active women losing their livelihoods, their incomes. It's impacted on their relationships. They've experienced...
Can you come to a question, please, Ms. Johnson?
Yes, I'd like to understand... You know, women are unable to lift up their own children. I'd like to understand what ongoing support the government is giving to the survivors, their partners and their families.
Shona Robson.
Well, Alison Johnson makes a really, really important point here, and that is about fully informed consent. And that women who, many of whom have horrendous stress urinary incontinence symptoms, if they come forward for treatment, that is really, really important that the clinician fully informs them of all of the risks of any procedure, and that this report recommendation is very, very clear that women should be taken through all of the options, including non-mesh and mesh options, and all of the risks associated with all of that explained fully to them. Plus, patient information leaflets have to ensure that that is clearly set out for those women so a fully informed decision can be made. In terms of ongoing support, we would expect our services, whether that's a health service or other services, to be supporting women who need that support. And if Alison Johnson wants more detail of that, then I'd be happy to write to her with that.
Mike Rumbles, followed by Alex Neil.
I'd like to thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. My question focuses on the precautionary principle. So how many health boards ignored both the previous Health Secretary Alex Neil's and the current Secretary's request for a suspension of this procedure until this independent review reported? And does the Minister know how many of these procedures have taken place across the country since the Health Secretary's request was first made and ignored?
Shona Robson.
Well, let me say to Mike Rumbles, firstly, that as I've said a number of times, and I think Alec Neil previously to me said, because this was not a banned procedure, if a woman agreed in the light of all of the risks being explained to her that she wanted to go ahead with this procedure, then there was nothing that would stop that if it was fully informed consent. So moving on to the specific question about how many mesh procedures have been carried out, I can tell the member that between June 2014 and September 2016, there were 148 trans obturator tape procedures carried out, 38 transvaginal mesh procedures for pelvic organ prolapse, and 327 trans abdominal procedures also for pelvic organ prolapse. What I can say is that those procedures, the trans obturator tape procedures, the report now recommends retropubic tape, not trans obturator tape procedures. And as I've said in answer to a number of questions, in terms of the pelvic organ prolapse, the report is very, very clear and recommends that that must not be routinely offered. So those numbers of procedures, the 38 transvaginal and the 327 transabdominal procedures, we would not expect health boards to now routinely offer those in the light of this clinical guidance. And the Chief Medical Officer will take forward the detail with every health board, and we would expect them to implement that before the suspension is lifted.
Can I say to members, we've already used up the time allocated for questions on this, but I'm willing to have a few more minutes to allow more questions. So can I have Alex Neil to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you very much indeed, the Deputy Presiding Officer, for extending the time slightly. Can I say, as the Cabinet Secretary who set up the inquiry, I'm disturbed and disappointed we've ended up where we have ended up. And can I say to the Cabinet Secretary that I absolutely think we cannot just leave things as they are, and therefore I welcome that part of her statement where she said that she's minded to carry out a formal review of the process, because how we got from a unanimous decision of the review group on the interim report to where we got to with the final report and all the unanswered questions from the women, the allegations from the consultant who also believed that this was a betrayal, I don't think we can leave it there for the credibility of the report, its recommendations, and indeed for the implications for future reviews of this kind. If we don't carry the confidence and trust of our patients, then these reports will not be worth the paper they're written on.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let me start by also saying I absolutely recognise Alec Neil's role in when he was previously Cabinet Secretary for Health and in establishing much of the work around this issue. Can I say to Alec Neil, as I said in my statement, I think there is an issue about the process here of the independent review that we need to learn lessons from. However, I need to be absolutely clear what this isn't about is opening up and reviewing the clinical evidence or indeed the conclusions and recommendations of the report. What we will do, though, is to look at the lessons learned about the process, because I think it is important when patients are involved, particularly in independent reviews, there can often be a power imbalance there in terms of the dynamics of reviews. And I think it's really important that we learn lessons from this and that recommendations are brought to ministers and that can then inform guidance to not just the chairs of future independent reviews, but also the members and the terms of reference that those independent reviews have. Very happy to keep Parliament informed of the detail. I would expect someone independent to take that forward, and very happy to keep Alec Neil informed.
This will be the last question in this session. Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm sorry I missed the very beginning of the statement. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the report discusses the use of a standalone database system. However, given that the current BSUG database can only be used by a relatively small proportion of surgeons and not general practice, as the report notes, will the Cabinet Secretary consider using a comprehensive and independent database so a much wider range of medical professionals can use it to report adverse incidents and concerns, as well as track patient progress?
Shona Robson.
Well, as I said in my statement, the monitoring of adverse incidents and the data gathering is really, really important and a key part of the recommendation. The oversight group that's being established will be taking forward much of the detail of this, and I'm very, very clear that we need to make sure that there's a transparency to all of that data coming forward so that people can see for themselves the information and data that is coming forward. So very happy to keep Donald Cameron involved around the detail of that as we take it forward.
That ends the question session on the statement on transvaginal mesh implants, and we'll move on to the next item of business.